Welcome to the NYU Steinhardt Jazz Interview Series. And today we have one of the great icons in jazz flute, Mr. Hubert Laws. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you for the invitation.
All right. So I want to start off with your early background. I know that you came from a very musical family in Houston.
Mm-hmm.
And was there something special about Houston? Because there's so many great musicians that have come through that part of the country.
Well, music is, I think, is so somewhat natural to many locations. It's just, I think it's just the orientation. I happen to come from a family where gospel music was prevalent. My mother played the piano for the local Baptist church choir. Therefore, we had a piano in the home. And she tells me when I was like 4 or 5, she says, I ventured up to the keyboard and started writing music. When I say write, I'm talking about playing music.
Mm-hmm.
And that's interesting to me because apparently I was using something that was given, which is a gift for discerning sound, and to duplicate that sound by going to the keyboard. At that time, that was the first instrument that I was ever introduced to. So not only was I introduced to that instrument, but my siblings as well. Ronnie, Eloise, Deborah, Blanche. So I did not become familiar with improvised music until like when I entered high school. And I was introduced by my high school band director, God bless him, is Sammy Harris. And he introduced us. When I say us, I'm talking about the group that later came to be known as the Crusaders, the Jazz Crusaders. Wayne Henderson, Joe Sample, Wilton Felder, Stix Huber, bass player Lala. And we were shown what was going on jazz-wise at that time. I was totally oblivious to what was happening with jazz until Sammy Harris introduced us to that music.
And what music did he introduce you to?
I remember he was playing Cannonball Adderley. I had heard on the radio Stan Kenton and, you know, Lee Konitz, people like that. Very impressed by Lee Konitz. And, but I was unaware of people like Cannonball and Bird, Coltrane. And he was the one who was instrumental in making us aware of that.
This has been around 1960?
That was in the late 50s. Yeah. Because I was in high school from 53 to 56. I finished high school when I was 15 because I had been skipped a couple of times, you know. Mm-hmm. But anyway, yeah, I was introduced during that period of time. What happened was there was a high school band, marching band, but within the confines of that group, we formed, well, there was also a dance band. And out of that dance band, Stix Huber, who's always been like a pioneer, you know, and he's had that acumen since, I mean, really young. He still has it, Stix Huber. And he was the one who put the group together, the six of us. And as a result, at the end result of that collaboration was that we left after everybody finished high school, and we waited, Joe Sample and Stix and I had gone on to TSU, Texas Southern University, to wait for Wayne, Wilton, and Lala to finish high school. Then we had our cars in a caravan, drove from Houston to Los Angeles, and then, you know, the rest you probably read about.
Well, how did that success come? Was that slow with the Crusaders?
Well, actually, I don't know what you consider slow, but I was with that group for 2 years there. I was learning to play the flute in a way that I, you know, the classical players play, you know, in the orchestra, symphony orchestra. And that was my, at that time, that was my desire. I wanted to, you know, get that sound. I wanted a different sound out of the flute. I had not heard that sound in jazz. These guys, most of the guys that played flute were like doublers. And I was a doubler as well for a while. But as a result of that, I auditioned for the Juilliard School of Music, which included not only flute players, but all instrumentalists, violin. And as a matter of fact, in the finals, there was a flute, there was a violin, and piano. So obviously, I was very shocked when the guy called me and told me I got the scholarship to Juilliard. And that's when I actually left the Crusaders. They weren't called the Crusaders at that time. They didn't adopt that name until I think maybe a couple of years later.
What was their first name?
Well, we were in Houston, we called ourselves a modern jazz sextet. And then when we got to Los Angeles, we called ourselves the Swingsters and then the Nighthawks. And from the Nighthawks, it evolved into what's known as a Crusader. Well, it was a Jazz Crusaders, and then later on they dropped the word jazz for commercial reasons.
So did you find that playing the flute was, it was going to be difficult to play jazz because it was an instrument that very few people had dealt with in jazz at that point?
I never even thought about it, Dave. You know, it's so interesting how I'm not a victim, but a beneficiary of circumstances. Because little by little, things happened. You know, of course, as I mentioned earlier, I had the background in gospel music, which is heavily involved in some form of improvisation, you know. So, and then here I was, I didn't tell you this story. I mean, I was, while at Texas Southern, we were required to go for a music appreciation course to go and listen to the Houston Symphony once a week. One night I was traveling to hear the concert and ran into two flute players. And of course, at Texas Southern, there was no flute teacher. So I took it upon myself to pursue a flute teacher outside of the school.
Why was there no flute teacher?
I have no idea. I mean, you're in the school, you know that there are certain things maybe economically that mm-hmm. affects decisions, right? So maybe at that time, there was no flute teacher for that reason. I have no idea. I never really questioned it. Just floating along and with circumstances like jazz music is improvised.
Mm-hmm.
My life has been pretty much like that. I'll tell you how I started playing flute. It's very interesting. In the high school band, Sammy Harris I mentioned earlier, in that high school band, he decided he wanted to play the William Tell Overture. I don't know, most people know the William Tell Overture is like the Lone Ranger's theme.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a prelude to that before that theme comes up. And that's where the big flute solo is. During that particular time, I didn't play flute. But a friend of mine just happened to have a flute in his attic. Sonny King, I won't forget, Sonny King had a flute in his attic, old beat up flute. And he gave it to me just about that time to play that particular song or that piece of music. And when I first started playing flute, man, it became a strong, strong attraction. And there, as a matter of fact, during that same period of time, Wilton bought a bassoon. Because there was this Australia jazz quartet. I don't know if you ever heard about them. And I heard, and they did a record, you know, I remember seeing the flamingos on the cover. And so there was a flute, bassoon, bass, and drums. There was not a piano. And, you know, being young as we are, we say, well, I want to duplicate, I want to get that sound. So that's why we ended up him getting that bassoon. And of course, my motivation was, like I mentioned, that William Tell Overture by Rossini. But I became more attracted and I gravitated so much stronger to that instrument than he did with the bassoon. you know, Wilton passed away not long ago. You know that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But he and I were in that group, and that was one of the alternate sounds that we had in the Crusaders. It didn't become very popular, but certainly it was a catalyst to what I ended up doing, mm-hmm. you know. As a matter of fact, I ended up using the flute. It's interesting. I used to use jazz as a support factor for learning to play classical music. In other words, I came up with that phrase recently, and I said, you know, I use jazz to support my classical habit. So I told these guys, they kind of feel, you know, they think that's kind of funny. And it is true, because I had an attitude, like most people do today in our society, where we have the optimum class of music, art, or even the boundaries that are set, educating us to feel that something is better than the other one. And of course, I was, you know, I was victimized by that mindset too. So I grew up. In fact, that's why I ended up playing with the New York Philharmonic with my teacher Julius Baker, 5 years, and I played 5 years with the Met simultaneously. It was, you know, going in and out, because I love the music so much. The wonderful composers, you know, who wrote that music, and I wanted to be involved in that. However, something else took over. I was treating improvisation almost like a stepchild, you know, as though, it was not as valuable, because, you know, society in general devaluates this form of music, unfortunately. So they don't support it. Many of the foundations, you know, I'm talking about these rich foundations that support classical music. That's how the orchestras exist. I know, because when I was in the Philharmonic, and also the Met, man, you know, they can't be supported solely by attendance. Can't. Impossible. And especially the benefits. I mean, there's systemic benefits that go to classical musicians that are totally ignored for improvising musicians. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm.
Incredible. Yeah. Now, how do we get all of this? Please get to all of this.
Let me ask you something. You're talking about maybe having an attraction to the flute. Did you ever know Russ on Roland Kirk?
I knew him personally, yes.
And I had heard the story where he had a dream that he visualized some instruments in an attic, and it was the Strichen and the Manzello that he found, and those became his other instruments.
Wow.
But beyond that, he had a very unique way of playing flute as well.
Mm-hmm.
So what was Roland Kirk like?
Well, I mean, he was dynamic, very forceful and very energetic. So I remember him, he was very energetic. I mean, in 1975, we did a downbeat jazz awards show, and it was televised. You can probably see it, because YouTube has made everything available now for free. And that was the last time I played on the same show with him. And of course, typical Roland Kirk is always a Rassan, was very, very energetic, you know, playing more than one instrument in his mouth, like two and three, you know, saxophone, mazzella, whatever you call that instrument. So that's what I recall about him. And I do recall he lived on Central Park.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere in the 100 and something, because I went over there once, I believe. But that's what I know about him.
But it was interesting with his flute approach. He would also hum into the flute or growl into the flute,
mm-hmm.
and that became kind of his sound. You know, I don't remember ever hearing you do that.
No, because you see, but he wasn't the first one to do that. There were some other people who did that. Did you ever hear Jeremy Steig?
Sure.
I think Jeremy Steig did that. I mean, there are a lot of people who do, which is not very difficult to do. I mean, that's an easy technique. I mean, you know, you can do that. You blow and at the same time hum into it. It's not very difficult. I have done it, but it was only for effect.
Mm-hmm.
It was not for any particular artistic achievement, you know. But it is like when people hear it, they think it's something that's sensational. Most people.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily, it's not. Artistically, it's not that difficult to achieve.
In effect, right. You were in New York Juilliard, you studied with Julius Baker, one mm-hmm. of the great flute players. Mm-hmm. And I was watching one of your interviews where you said that you wanted to have him check out some jazz, so you took him to Birdland to hear Freddie Hubbard play, and you wow. turned him into a jazz fan.
Well, that was very interesting, too, because, you know, Julius Baker, see, I was a student, and of course, I wasn't aware of some of the dynamics involved with Julie. But I knew that he understood virtuosity. And you know what Freddie R. Hubbard was. Mm-hmm. He was, for me, he was the most virtuoso on this instrument. Tone, technique, everything. That guy, incredible. And I was honored to be able to record with him and play with him live. But this one Saturday, I was at my flute lesson, and I told Julie, I said, man, I want you to come with me. I want you to come with me to Birdland. I want you to hear this trumpet player. Freddie was playing with the Jazz Messengers. Excuse me. Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. Art Blakey on drums, and Cedar Walton on piano. Reggie Workman. I think it was Wayne Shorter. Yeah, was Wayne Shorter. And Curtis Fuller on trombone. And all of them are virtuosos, but I thought that he would be most impressed with Freddie Hubbard. And sure enough, he was. So, because all he knew about jazz was this guy Morales who played flute from Cuba. That's mm-hmm. all he knew. In fact, he said, because he wanted to hear me play jazz, and he says, yeah, you ever hear me play he played this solo that he had knew note for note by Morales, I think the guy's name was. And you know, of course, Julie Baker had, the biggest sound. His intonation was incredible. And his technique. Oh, my God, this guy played an Ebert concerto for flute live with orchestra. And you're hard-pressed to hear any mistakes. Mm. And that's what really impressed me about Julie. And so I started, man, to this day, I still practice that piece. It's not very easy to do, but he did it. And he got accolades from flute players all over the country when he did that live. It was RCA live. You know, RCA did these live concerts. I think Toscanini was a conductor. Mm-hmm. And but aside from that, you know, he's like an unsung hero. I mean, you hear people like, during that time, you hear about Jean-Pierre Rampal, and mm-hmm. who's a fine flutist from Paris. And then you hear about James Galway. But this guy, in my estimation, there was no one who surpassed Julius Baker mm-hmm. in that field.
Did he come and hear you play jazz?
Oh, I give you, what happened was he used to have this workshop up there in Brewster where he had his house, northern New York. And he had a bunch of students up there, you know, and we were playing trios with him, Galway, and myself. And I remember we played these trios, and then one or two of those students stood up there and said, Mr. Laws, could you please play some jazz for us? And that's why, I don't remember what I played, but I probably played a little bit of jazz. That was probably the only time you heard me play jazz.
Mm. Was Galway his student too?
Who? No, Galway was, I think he played in the Berlin Philharmonic for years.
Mm. But he was at that same...
He was at the seminar there.
Ah.
We were playing trios.
Wow. So... I'd like to talk about your connection to Creed Taylor and CTI Records. You've done a lot there.
Mm-hmm.
And how did that start?
Well, interesting. I was playing a local television program here, a David Frost TV show. And Billy Taylor had the band. And there were about eight of us he had chosen. And we had a conference in the room. He says, look, guys, I convinced the producers that I handpick you guys. So you can't send in subs, you know, because guys who get better gigs, they're gonna send in some subs and go take a better gig.
Yeah.
Well, I had to take off the first time, and he conceded, and then there was no consequence. But the second time, I got this call from Creed, who was down there in Memphis, Tennessee, with this rhythm section, who was supposed to accompany Stanley Turrentine. He was either Stanley Turrentine, I gotta get that straight, it was either Stanley Turrentine or Hank Crawford. But neither one of them showed up. I think it was Hank, because Hank was in jail for some reason, you know. Mm-hmm. So he could make it. So Cree called me up and asked me, could I fly down there and record with this rhythm section?
Playing flute.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know why I did it, because I gave up the best paying job in the city. Jimmy Owens was on trumpet. There was Frank West, one of them. I remember Bobby Thomas on drums, Bob Cranshaw on bass. Several guys, you know, that had been handpicked. But I knew if I took off, I was going to lose that job. And I took off with no promise of anything. Mm-hmm. I'm serious. I mean, I to this day, I don't understand why I made that decision. But it resulted in me being the first artist he signed for his record company, CTI. And I did this record called Crying Song. Now, after that, he signed Freddie Hubbard and I think Stanley Turrentine and later Bob James, some other people. But although we didn't get much payment from being with that company, the notoriety is what spawned the big record companies getting the attention and as a result, signing us. This is after Creed had tried to open up his own distribution. It was kind of difficult, and he kind of lost revenues. But in the meantime, I had no idea that record companies like Sony, well, at that time it was CBS, eventually became Sony, that signed people with that kind of money. I had no idea. And then I found out that's what they do for those rock guys, mm-hmm. rock artists, that kind of money they give to them. But it was at that time that I was able to start my own production company. I actually built my own recording studio in Los Angeles. I took all that money, and I didn't go out and spend it, you know, for trivial stuff, you know. I actually invested it, and I still have my own recording studio. But my relationship with Creed has continued. As a matter of fact, I visited him and his wife in Fort Lauderdale, where he has a second home, just last year when we did that jazz cruise. We took off from Fort Lauderdale, and his house is right there, so he invited me over, and we talk regularly on the phone. Yeah, Creed Taylor. He was very innovative type guy, because the production of his artist was very unique, and that's why the big record companies like CBS and RCA, Warner Brothers, because the Warner Brothers signed George Benson, and you know, he had this huge hit, This Masquerade. And I remember Stanley went to Fantasy, Freddie Hubbard, Bob James, and I ended up at CBS. And like that, that's what happened. And you know, although you had all these record companies offering these, you know, vying for our contract, I knew that even though Creed was offering as much money as CBS, I knew he wouldn't be able to deliver. And so it did destroy the friendship, you know, but still, you know, that was one of the best moves I made. So you see, that decision I made to fly down to Memphis, because they had that same rhythm section that did Memphis Underground with Herbie.
Herbie, yeah.
Yeah. So that's why he thought it would be a successful venture for his company.
With CTI, did you get to select the pieces? There were a lot of classical pieces. There was Rite of Spring. There was Syrinx. There was Farandole. So many different classical. Was that your idea to bring your classical element into the?
Well, I remember some meetings that we would have up there at right there at Rockefeller Center, where his office was at that time. Don Sebesky, Creed, and I would meet and talk about future projects. And I do know we were kind of touring around with classical pieces because, you know, my flute, the more natural environment for the flute was in the orchestra, you know, and chamber music. So we threw around some pieces, and Rite of Spring was one of them. Syrinx was one of them. Some other pieces, but anyway, that has become like a mainstay. I mean, we played a concert recently at downtown Los Angeles with my group. We did our modern version of Rite of Spring, and it was, man, people jumped up on their feet after we finished it. I think it's because it was like an incentive for people who had previously been exposed to only classical music, there was this bridge for classical music and jazz to coexist. Mm-hmm. So, but anyway, that's why we did some of the classical things. And of course, my background, I knew about these pieces. I had played them in the orchestras when I was at school, and also when I was at the Met and the Philharmonic. So,
maybe what's the connection, your working relationship with Don Sebesky, with all those records at CTI?
Don Sebesky was like the resident arranger for Creed. Mm-hmm. So whenever Creed would record a rhythm section like Freddie or Stanley, Chet Baker, Warren Carter, Bob James, well, Bob would generally write his own arrangements, but Don was, he was the one who, something very interesting about Don. When we did The Rite of Spring, mm-hmm. I still got the parts. He sat down out in his car, outside of Rudy Van Gelder's studio, and jotted down the arrangements. The arrangement, I mean, pencil.
Just off the top of his head.
Yeah. Guy's incredible, man. You know, and he wrote, and of course, now, another experience I had with him is when I decided I would record Amazing Grace. Now, Amazing Grace was actually stimulated by an interaction I had with my dad. I had bought him this boat, and he loved to fish right down in Houston. He'd gone fishing, and he was there watering down the boat, the salt water off of it, and I heard him humming Amazing Grace. And I told him, I said, Dad, you know what? I'm going to record that piece for you. So I went back to to New York, and I presented that idea to Creed, and then he presented the idea to Don. Now Don was not aware of the history of Amazing Grace, obviously, because the first section was very slow and arduous, you know, and very beautiful, you know, strings and all that. But they said, now we're going to take it up, you know, the tempo, mm-hmm. and make it almost rock. I said, Don, you don't understand, man. You can't do that. So that was it. That was the birth of that. Now that was just one thing, you know. Of course, Don was always also very, very. I guess you can use the word concessionary, because he would, if you make a suggestion, he would go with it. But this guy, oh my goodness, his arrangements. Matter of fact, I took an arrangement course with him.
I'd like to go back to Freddie Hubbard for a minute, one of the great improvisers, and it almost seems like effortless flow coming out of him. Mm-hmm. How much effort did it take to be somebody like Freddie Hubbard, and for you, for that matter of fact?
Well, Freddie, you know, it's amazing to me how this guy, first of all, he played the B-flat instrument, the trumpet, okay, which meant, you know, when you write changes for him, you would imagine you'd write it for B-flat instrument, but no. He always wanted his changes writ concert key, which is great, because, you know, anybody come in with a tune, you can just, you know, but that guy, he I don't know what it was. I mean, to me, it's like Chick, you know. Chick has the same kind of ability. I mean, he's just natural. You know, he can't play badly, and neither did I hear Freddie play badly. The guy could just venture to new changes and just star. I mean, it's just, whereas I felt like I had to work hard, man, learn those changes, and then adapt my mind to the sound of the chord. But Freddie Hubbard, my goodness, he had such a tremendous and energy level. Matter of fact, Freddie, he was dealing with some problems with, I don't know, he told me this. He was playing so much at this one night at this club that he was, started bleeding. His lip started bleeding. I guess he was oblivious to what was going on with his lip. So later, it sounds like, I mean, I kind of remember he was up in San Francisco area. He went to the doctor, excuse me, and the doctor actually clipped this little nipple that develops with brass players, clipped it, not knowing that that was an essential part of his blowing. And after that, Freddie could hardly hold a whole note. Did you know that? The last 10 years of his life, he could hardly. I remember when we went to Bermuda to play this gig. That was the same gig that Stanley Turrentine was supposed to meet us on, and he passed away. He had a stroke that same period of time. So he and Freddie Hubbard, Grady Tate, Blob Cranshaw, my piano player, actually, David Budway. And we went on to Bermuda thinking that that Stanley was going to join us. And never happened. The next day we found out he passed away, man. That was, we were in Bermuda at that time. But I remember announcing to the audience, you know, how great Freddie Hubbard is, but this guy, but he was, you know, he had big ego, so.
Yeah.
You know, so he wouldn't tell the people, you know, because, man, it was so sad because he couldn't play.
Well, I know Freddie was close to Coltrane, and he was on a few records. Did he talk about Coltrane, or did you ever get a chance to meet him?
I met Coltrane once at the Vanguard. I was down in the back of the kitchen, and I had my piccolo for some reason. He asked to play my piccolo. I was telling Ravi, his son, who was playing with us there with Chick this week, and I said, man, I met your dad. Now, he doesn't even remember Coltrane, because right. He was only 2 years old when his father passed away in 67. But no, Freddie never talked about Coltrane too much. I do know that he did record with him and some of the, but even back then, even when he was so young, he was able to, you know, his ability, man, was just so evident. Like Chick, I mean, Chick and I met at Juilliard back in the 60s, 1960. That guy was playing like that then. It was incredible. You know, some of us, now see, because I had paid so much attention to classical music, I just took improvisation for granted. So I didn't really work hard at it. Mm-hmm. Then I come to learn, you know, the guys who do it all the time, they were focused on that. So later in my life, I began to think, wow, man, you better focus on what's really supporting you. And that's what I ended up doing. That's what I do now. I mean, that's why I sit, you know, with Chick stuff, man, I sit and study it more so than I'm playing like a Mozart concerto. You know, and that's the kind of respect we should develop for all the music. Like I said, you know, I was so influenced by our system that we live in, that geographically, and put boundaries on not only land, but on people. You know, and they try to elevate one over the other. When you find out music, man, God, music is a leveler. What they say is, in other words. You know, it puts you on even ground.
You know? Well, I was listening to the tune, Chick's tune, Windows, with you, and mm-hmm. Chick, beautiful. Mm-hmm. But going back to Coltrane, I was listening to your version of Moment's Notice, which is killing. How do you get, let me ask you a technical question. It's like your lines are very well laid out. Well, I asked Mike Richmond about you. Mm-hmm. Today, because I said you worked on the road with Hubert, right? Mm-hmm. And he said, "Well, he's a bebopper." He says he's a bebopper. I said, "Did he, you know, coming from a classical background, was any of this worked out?" And he says, "No, man. Every night he's a bebopper. He's playing those lines, and your lines are so well constructed."
Wow, I'm not aware of that. I can only attribute that to my grand creator, man. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, like I said, whatever we have is given to us. Now, we can work on it. It's just like a woman, you know, a woman can have her natural features, but she puts on makeup. You know, she puts on makeup to try to enhance her features. Well, that's what we do with a natural raw talent. We can try to, you know, we work hard to try to dress it up to make it presentable. Mm-hmm. And that's what I started doing even more so nowadays, giving more respect. Because I was influenced, like I said, I was influenced by society in which we live that elevates, you know, optimizes respect for classical music and saying this is a zenith. And even some of my peers when at school, man, they didn't show that respect. I mean, they, you know, was jazz okay? Jazz is okay. That's why I took my teacher to hear Freddie. Mm-hmm. It changed his whole outlook. He's dead now, but it changed his outlook.
So as far as your time and rhythm, mm-hmm. Who did you borrow that from? Who did you listen to? Say was it Freddie? Was it somebody that was just like able to burn right on top of the rhythm, beautiful eighth note lines?
Well, I listened to so many people, you know. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, when I was a teenager, I used to learned for note for note Lee Konitz solos. Mm-hmm. He did this. In fact, I called Lee not long ago. I said, "Man, when I get to New York, I want to take you to lunch or dinner." I said, "Some of the stuff you did back there, man, when you were 20, he had to be about 21 years of age. Classic stuff." Mm-hmm. He's at, you know, I'd ask him questions like you're asking me about Moment's Notice, but that guy was so unique. Who could he have listened to make him play like that? He wasn't playing like anybody I knew back there. So he's about 85. He said, "Hubert, I'm 85 now."
Well, I've interviewed him as well, and we've talked about that, because I said, how can you have this being surrounded by guys like Charlie Parker? And that was the norm at that time. Mm. He came up with this other voice. And how did you do that? And part of that is, I think, he got involved with Lenny Tristano, mm-hmm. and Warren Marsh, and they started moving eighth notes around, or the here's a standard lick, let's move it by a half step this way or this way, mm-hmm. and kind of make the time feel a little more less obvious.
Dave, I'm going to tell you something. The music goes by so fast. I can't think about all those theoretical things. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm relating to the sound that's in the group. You know, there's a bass player, there may be a keyboard or a guitar, and I'm hearing these harmonies go by. So I'm reacting to that like spontaneously. That's why it's called jazz.
But there's also, and this is kind of the core of what we talk about here, there's a process to where you're able to stand up on stage and play that. It just didn't come to you miraculously. Mm. I think there's practice, there's dedication, there's persistence.
That's what I'm talking about earlier. It's like a woman putting on makeup, yeah. but you got the raw substance there. Mm-hmm. But what happens is, you know, by working and practicing, you know, I practice the materials of music, the scales. I don't do that much anymore. Now I listen to something and I look at what the chords are like, just like I'm, you know, I spent 2 days just in my hotel room. I didn't even go outside. Mm-hmm. I spent that day today in the bed because I was sick. But the other days I was actually scoping out these changes and figuring out how I can relate to them so it sounds like I'm playing within the spectrum or the outline that Chick wrote. Mm-hmm. See, but that stuff goes by so fast. And I tell you the truth, I wonder myself. I wonder, how does that happen? How does that happen? Mm-hmm. I'm not in complete control. I mean, my fingers just start relating. That's why I say that there must be divine intervention with that. Mm. Think about it. I mean, and many of us don't attribute it, you know, like I think, you know, Chick never mentions about divine intervention, but he has that. Freddie had it. Stanley Turrentine had it. I mean, Coltrane, all those guys had that, you know? So, you know, that's what I can attribute. What else can you say it comes from? Didn't come from just yourself. Mm-hmm. So where does it come from?
Good question.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, my conclusion is that it comes from a divine source, because music existed long, long before we started doing this improvisation. Mm-hmm. You know?
Well, let me ask you about performance. Do you ever have any performance anxiety?
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
But you know what is the panacea for that? Practice, preparation.
Yeah, and have you gotten to the point where, you know, it's different being in a practice room and practicing. It's another thing you're standing at Carnegie Hall or at the stage at the Blue Note or wherever, and all of a sudden there's distractions. Is there, I listened to an interview with Stan Getz once, and he said that he tries to get to what he called an alpha state, where he just thinks about the music, forgets about the crowd, and zones in, mm-hmm. and his fingers and his mind are all tuned to that.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that.
You've reached that?
Well, I mean, that's what really happens all alone. Mm-hmm. That's why I attribute it not to myself so much, we're like conduits, you know, because there's a force that comes through us and it goes through to the public. Mm-hmm. But that, you know, I give credit to a divine source.
I like that.
Yeah.
I don't know what else we can say beyond that, but how else you define that. Can you talk about what you still aspire to accomplish in music?
What I want to accomplish?
Yes. You've done so much, such a diversity of things. Is there something that you haven't done?
Well, I mean, I want to improve. I mean, I want to improve my ability to improvise and, you know, and adapt to changes. And, you know, I really want to improve that improvisational aspect, which I didn't focus on too much when I was younger. Like I said, I was so influenced by the mindset that we received from our the system we live in that, you know, that elevates this over the other. And as a result, I was elevating, you know, classical music over my ability to improvise. So I didn't pay much attention. I said, I can do that. So I didn't pay much attention to improvisation. So I would like to continue improving on that aspect. And it's very inspirational because you know what? Once you've learned a Beethoven or sonata or you know, Bach sonata, you've done it. But to be able to improvise, you know, Chick and I were talking about that last night. We were sitting down, he was talking about Scarlatti and Mozart. Now he happened to love Mozart and Scarlatti. I'm not that big a fan of Mozart. And I know, but he is, because his piano player, he thought some of his stuff. I say, man, your harmonic sense is so much more profound than what Mozart did. And why is it that you? He said, yeah, man, but you haven't heard some of his piano pieces. Yeah, but I know. At that time, stuff was so consonant back there. He and Haydn wrote similar music, because in the so-called classical music period. And but you know, the only symphony that I really listened to from Mozart was his 49th, called the Jupiter. Mm-hmm. It was interesting, Jupiter Symphony. But aside from that, I mean, I listened to people like Shostakovich. Oh my God, Shostakovich, Prokofiev, they have some really unique stuff going on in their music, man. Tchaikovsky, Richard Strauss. Man, that's some heavy stuff. And I still have a lot of respect for that. Now, when I used to play at the Met, you know, they did a lot of Wagner pieces, Richard Wagner, and it didn't always have a lot of flute work in it, but some of the flute players, rather than sit there and listen, then they want to go outside, read newspapers and smoke. And I said, man, how can you want to do that with all this beautiful music around you? Just because you're not involved in it doesn't invalidate that music. So, you know, I'm sitting there, man, I'm in my haven just listening to it. I don't have to participate, you know, until my time to participate. But I'm thinking about my teacher who had played in the recording. I went to this recording session where Stokowski conducted the Houston Symphony and Shostakovich's Symphony Number 11. That's one of my all-time, when I'm on the plane or anything, I want to pass an hour, because it's about an hour long. I listen to that piece and just amazed at how this guy can. See, you asked me a question about improvisation. I would love to interview Shostakovich, Richard Strauss, how those guys, and Prokofiev, how those guys write that stuff, man. Hey, have you ever heard his 11th Symphony? Mm-hmm. You have? The Houston Symphony? See, mm-hmm. There's several recordings, but the Houston Symphony, because Stokowski, I think he knew Shostakovich. And he was the one who conducted the orchestra in Houston. I told you where I met the two flute players. Mm-hmm. He was the one who conducted that orchestra. I heard the premiere. The first time they played that piece was in Houston, Texas. And I heard it. Mm. And my teacher who played piccolo in the orchestra invited me to the recording session. I never will forget it. He was playing, but those, I'm sure many of those guys who played in the orchestra are not cognizant, man, of the depth of that piece of music, man. And how are you able to do that? I mean, that's like genius involved in that stuff.
Truly.
There's genius involved in that. And in this case, the composer's improvisational thing is the orchestra. See, I play one little monotone instrument, but this guy, he's got control over a whole orchestra, and how he puts those parts together is truly amazing to me. Mm-hmm. That's why I say it's from a divine source. So when I hear that stuff, I'm saying, wow, it's got to be beyond a human being to do that. It's just like, you know, looking at the universe. You look at a tree. You just look at a tree. And the more close you look at it, the more intriguing it becomes. Your distance, you know, you don't see all the intricacies involved in the tree and the little spines and the little things that are involved in the tree creation. Well, same as with this music. The more you look close at it, the more intriguing you become. And intrigued you become, as I am. you know?
It's been a pleasure having you here today. And certainly, there are many, many people consider you the crossover, the bridge for classical people connecting to jazz and jazz people connecting to classical. And I have to thank you for that because you're very important in that respect.
Thank you, Dave. It's a pleasure talking about it, man. You bring out some things I didn't even, you know, I have in my head, but you helped me to bring out those memories, those unique experiences.
Well, Herbert, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Hubert Laws.